Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Chew the Bullet by Martha Carr and Michael Anderle, narrated by Amanda Friday. Chapter 1. Does this look level to you? Private First Class Idina Moorfield stepped back from the mostly built go-kart behind the Headquarters and Headquarters Company building and tilted her head. If she could have used her green lights to show her exactly where the problem was, she would have let them do the work for her. Idina wasn't that kind of engineer, and she wasn't a mechanic. She'd been learning how to take her unit's advice more and more, which was still mostly useless, but sometimes incredibly helpful. When none of Supply Support Section's other soldiers said a word, Idina raised an eyebrow and looked pointedly at Badge. That wasn't a rhetorical question. Then say that first. The only other woman in Idina's section looked up from the spare parts she'd arranged on the asphalt beside their newest self-directed project and studied the go-kart. Nope. Honestly, it looks like shit. Pill scoffed and shoved his thick glasses up the bridge of his nose with an index finger. Great way to boost morale, Badge. Thanks. We're gonna have to take it apart.
Aw, don't say that.
Trunk stood from his squat and dusted off his hands.
We've been on this thing for a week already. Now ain't the time to tell us. Stop. You fucked it all up. Start all over again.
Badge glared up at the giant soldier and gestured at the go-kart. Not my job to tell you, morons, you're doing it wrong.
If you knew.
I was busy, asshole, counting extra parts. Trunk sighed and folded his arms.
Quit whining and grab the manual.
Cake sat away from the rest of the unit on a pile of stacked crates they'd used to bring all the supplies out here in the first place, rifling through a catalog for building maintenance and repair supplies. He licked a finger before turning the next page, then looked up at the rest of the unit.
Cause it has directions.
Idina turned to look him up and down and smirked. Corporal Bunt, nicknamed Cake for the sake of amusement, and because it pissed him off, had been out here with the rest of the unit every day for the last week, while Idina and the others worked to build their DIY go-kart with spare, discarded parts gathered from around Fort Bragg Army Base. He's not lifting a finger to help, but at least he's out here. Now I have to figure out why. There's no way gambling and being a pain in the ass are the only things he's good for.
Yeah, yeah.
Skim brushed the dirt and debris off his OCP pants, which he'd been doing a lot more of the last few weeks, instead of letting the grime ride him as he had before, and scanned the area around their pet project.
Just find the manual, duh.
Well, look who's got all the helpful advice.
Pill stuck his hands on his hips and stared at Cake, who'd returned to flipping through the parts catalog that couldn't have been as interesting as he wanted everyone to believe.
How about you get up off your ass and help us find the thing?
Cake sniffed and perused the next page.
Hey, newbie, how many idiots does it take to find a fucking instruction manual?
Idina ignored him and joined the others, searching for the manual they'd been referencing for the last week.
Shit.
Skim walked around the go-kart, stopped when he'd made a full circle, and scratched his head.
It's not here.
Come on, Pill whined. That was your one job today.
Hey, my job doesn't have a description, like yours.
Dude, it's not that hard. You show up in the break room, grab the only fucking book on the table, and take it with you so we have something to reference out here. I can't be your damn babysitter every day.
Skim turned in another slow circle and shrugged.
Okay.
Yeah, great. You don't even care.
Pill turned toward Idina with an angry red flush rising on the sides of his neck and into his cheeks.
He doesn't give a shit about anything.
You give a shit about way too much,
Badge muttered. Trunk snickered.
Yeah, man. Maybe you should sit before you hurt yourself. Before I hurt him,
Cake added, without looking away from the catalog. Idina lifted both hands in concession and strolled around the go-kart they'd built, almost 90% at this point. The break room's right there.
Hey, look.
Cake sneered at her.
The newbie's here to save the day. Have a cookie.
Aw. Idina clicked her tongue.
That's so sweet. Maybe you should go get it.
Pill pointed at Cake.
All you do is sit on your ass and spew shitty one-liners while the rest of us are trying to get something done.
I'm the ranking soldier, Cake said blandly. I don't have to do anything.
Man, you ain't earned the right to ride our backs,
Trunk added.
I haven't earned it.
Cake tossed the catalog to the asphalt and jumped to his feet.
The fuck I haven't. You don't know shit about what I've done, so back the fuck off.
Badge rolled her eyes and let out a low whistle.
Somebody's getting to triggered.
You want to see triggered?
He flipped her the bird and stormed toward her.
I'll show you. Mainframe assembly,
Stop shouted. Pipe steel front to back, 62 inches. Everybody froze and turned to look at the soldier who normally kept his mouth shut and stayed out of the limelight. When he did speak, what came out was usually incomprehensible.
What?
Cake shook his head.
Dude, if you don't have something real to say, don't fucking...
Hold on. Idina headed slowly around the unfinished go-kart toward stop. Do that again.
No, keep your fucking mouth shut, man. Newbie, you gotta quit encouraging him. Dude, shut up.
She stared at the corporal, raised her eyebrows, and managed a fairly intimidating, don't screw with me face. Cake did shut up, although he flipped her the middle finger before stalking back toward his stacked crates and his oh-so-entertaining catalog browsing. Idina felt the rest of her unit staring at her, everyone a little on edge again, because she dared to put the corporal in his place, whatever that was. Private First Class Moorfield was too focused on stop to care. Go ahead, she told him gently. Do that again. Stop lifted a fist to his mouth, cleared his throat, and did exactly that. Front to bucket seats, 58.5 inches. She nodded, her smirk returning now. Keep going. Drive axle setup assembly, lawnmower differential with a 13-tooth sprocket and a 9-tooth axle.
This is bullshit,
Cake muttered. Nobody in Triple S paid him any attention, because the other soldiers were starting to pick up on what Stop had been doing. Pill looked back and forth between Idina and Stop before pointing at the private who hardly said much of anything.
Did he?
She nodded, her smile growing.
I think so, yeah.
Well, hot damn.
Trunk folded his arms and snickered.
Do it again.
Stop rattled off another few lines from the instruction manual before he was interrupted again.
Was that where we left off?
Badge asked, her spare parts forgotten now at the realization. Stop grinned at her, nodded vigorously, and repeated what he'd said verbatim.
Holy shit.
Skim looked the other soldier up and down and dropped out of his crouch to sit on the asphalt, propping himself up with his hands stretched out behind him.
Did you read the whole thing?
The question alone made Stop's wide blue eyes light up even further, and he shot everyone two thumbs up. At-home go-kart instruction manual, 4th edition.
Prove it.
Badge sounded like her usual, prickly, overly skeptical self, but now a small smile had curled the corners of her mouth, too.
First paragraph of chapter 2.
When Stop let out the entire string of instructions in one breath, Trunk burst out laughing.
No fucking way, man. Screw the first paragraph.
Skim pointed at Stop. 4th sentence on page 60. Stop immediately recited a string of mechanical jargon, and the soldiers whooped and hollered in disbelief. Badge pounded a fist against Trunk's rock-solid calf beside her, and he didn't notice.
Okay.
Pill shoved his glasses back up his nose and chuckled.
I have to admit, that's pretty incredible.
How the hell does this impress you?
Cake fixed them with a disgusted sneer.
Come on, the guy's got way too many screws loose up there. Hey, man.
Trunk interrupted.
Take it easy.
It's true.
Badge snorted.
You don't have any issues, huh?
I never said that. I'm not trying to be some kind of idiot savant.
Cake tossed a hand toward Stop, who now stood rigid, his gaze darting back and forth to every face within their unit.
You know what? Fuck it. I'll bet my Xbox he's making it all up. Man, you got yourself a deal.
Trunk stomped toward the corporal and reached out to shake on it. Cake looked him up and down.
You got something to throw in the pot or what?
The giant soldier slowly lowered his hand, stared up at the clear blue sky, and huffed out a disappointed sigh.
Shit.
I'll take that bet, Idina said. The feral-looking grin spreading across Cake's face immediately told her she'd hit gold with that offer. The guy couldn't help himself. Too much gambling was, after all, part of why he'd been transferred out of his old unit and shipped off to HHC.
You're on, newbie. Better make it something interesting.
The cost of another Xbox. How's that? Skim burst out laughing, but didn't say anything. Stop looked down at him and caught the other soldier's contagious amusement, even if he looked like he had no idea what was so funny.
Fucking peachy.
Cake nodded toward the back of the HHC building.
Now we need the manual.
Yep. Trying to hide her smirk, Idina spun toward the back of the building to finish what she'd already volunteered to do.
Whoa, 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 not you, newbie.
Cake stood and pointed at Pill.
The walking disease can get it.
Pill clicked his tongue.
Nobody ever taught you how to say please, did they?
He still stormed toward the back door into the HHC building anyway and disappeared. Nobody moved for 5 minutes while Specialist Engelman retrieved the go-kart's assembly manual from the supply room, although she felt Cake's eyes on her the whole time and guessed that Trunk, Badge, and Skim were all staring at the corporal, Idina focused only on Stop. The guy had shoved his hands into his pockets and rocked back and forth on his heels, staring at the asphalt and muttering something under his breath.
This is his thing. Nobody else wanted to pay attention, but now we're about to prove it.
Stop flicked his gaze up toward her, let out an uncertain chuckle, and picked up his rocking and muttering again. When Pill returned with the thick instruction manual, Cake strode across the back lot toward him.
You take forever.
Pill whisked the manual out of Cake's reach and grinned.
You made a bet, Corporal. You don't get to call the shots.
Can't be the cake and eat it too.
Badge snickered. Trunk looked sharply at her, then burst into roaring laughter.
Fine.
Cake folded his arms.
I don't trust you not to rig the answers either.
Jesus Christ.
With a growling, exaggerated groan, Badge stormed toward them and snatched the manual from Pill's hands.
Shut up and give me that. Bunch of fucking babies over here.
She returned to her previous spot, standing beside Trunk, and rifled through the manual's pages.
Okay, page 102, second paragraph,
third sentence.
Trunk finished for her.
God damn it!
Stop ignored the side chatter and blinked once before reciting a short line that sounded a hell of a lot like he'd taken it straight from the book. He finished with, page 102, paragraph 2, line 3. And nodded curtly. Everyone waited in silence to hear the results. Badge slowly looked up from the open manual in her hands and grinned. At the sight, Pill took a step back.
You little fucker!
Ha, see?
Skim shook a finger at Stop and leapt to his feet.
He's fucking Rain Man! Lucky break!
Cake tried to keep his disappointment and frustration at bay.
Pick another one.
Badge rolled her eyes, but rifled through the manual anyway, calling out page numbers, paragraphs, and lines. She even quizzed Stop on the captions to multiple images inserted into the text to throw him off. Private Markle repeated the given content verbatim, line by line, without pausing to think about it. By the time Cake finally stopped demanding test after test, the rest of the unit was howling with laughter.
No shit, man.
Trunk gestured toward Stop.
Dude's got the photographic memory.
A fucking machine.
Pill dragged both hands down his cheeks and stared at Stop, but his incredulous smile kept growing.
I don't know how that's possible. Even an above-average human brain isn't capable of retaining that much information at the same time.
That's why he doesn't say anything.
Skim clapped Stop's shoulder and gave him a little shake.
Guy opens his mouth and spews nothing but knowledge. He'd break us.
Stop snickered and scanned the sky.
Knowledge.
Badge turned toward Cake and cocked her head.
Time for you to pay up, asshat.
I don't owe you shit. You placed a bet with the newbie, man.
Trunk's low, rumbling laughter echoed around the back parking lot.
She fucking schooled your ass. hard. Shut up.
Idina folded her arms and nodded at the corporal. I'll give you to the end of the week to say your goodbyes. Then you gotta pay up. The rest of the unit exploded with laughter, including Stop. Cake gritted his teeth so hard, his bottom jaw slid to the side.
Whatever. You're acting like he's the best thing since sliced fucking bread, but he's still got thrown in here with us.
As he returned to his stacked crates and pretended to be thoroughly engrossed in flipping through the catalog again, the rest of Triple S ignored him. They were too amazed and amused by having figured out Stop's astounding ability to file away an entire assembly manual in his head. Badge tossed the manual over her shoulder and got down on her knees in front of the go-kart. Fuck the book. Tell us what we screwed up, genius. Stop headed toward their project and pointed at the steering system.
Page 81, paragraph 2.
Then he pulled the instructions right out of his head again, and the rest of the unit didn't question what he was telling them.
Damn, we gotta take that top part off, huh?
No shit. Get me that wrench.
Anything else we missed?
Page 45, paragraph 4.
Idina joined her unit members huddled around the go-kart as Stop recited all the directions they'd gotten slightly wrong, and nobody had to fight over an instruction manual anymore. Oddly enough, it made them a hell of a lot faster at correcting the assembly mistakes together to finish it as a team.
That's what Major Hines wanted me to find. Private Timothy James Markle III has a computer for a brain. It's not keeping him on the sidelines anymore.
She grabbed one of the tools Pill asked her for and handed it over before glancing at Cake sidelong. The corporal tried so hard to look completely invested in his incredibly dry reading, but now and then, his gaze flicked up to fall on the rest of the unit. When it did, he'd snort or let himself smile before immediately killing it again. One time, he snickered and shook his head before diving back into his parts catalog.
Cake's as impressed as the rest of us.
Of the two soldiers in Triple S on whom Idina still hadn't managed to crack the code, so to speak, Corporal Bunt was now the last. Once she figured out what made Cake tick, the proof that he didn't belong in the new misfit unit someone had tossed them all in together, her little side mission for Major Hines would be complete.
Then I get my answers about the journal and my green lights. Hines better come through.
Chapter 2. Figuring out what made Cake exceptional, or at least more valuable than he'd made himself in the last 2.5 months of the supply support section's existence, was a lot harder than Idina expected, especially because she only had one soldier now to investigate, study, and report her findings back to Major Hines. The guy had improved a little in his punctuality and attendance over the last few weeks, meaning, at the very least, he showed up slightly before 0900 to report to the supply room with the rest of the unit and no longer skipped out an hour before they were technically relieved of duty for the day. Cake had started to show up on jobs, too, although he still sat apart from the rest of the unit, poked all their buttons, and tried to get a rise out of people instead of bothering to join them for the actual work. At the end of that week, Idina figured the best way to crack Corporal Bunt wide open was to poke back, give him a taste of his own medicine, and see if he buckled. That Friday morning gave her the perfect opportunity when Cake showed up to the supply room at 0906 hours with a large cardboard box in his arms. Pill looked up and shoved his daily prescription box back into his rucksack.
The week's not over till the end of the day.
What's your point?
You're late.
You can bite me.
Cake stopped at the single table in the center of the room, which they all shared now that Skim had adopted a newfound appreciation for personal hygiene, and dropped the box onto it with a thunk. A few loose pieces of plastic rattled around inside. Sitting at the table and eating the rest of a protein bar from the break room pantry, Idina looked up at him and slowly continued chewing.
You brought presents. You're a pain in the ass, you know that?
She shrugged and took another bite of the protein bar.
I pay my fucking debts.
Pill snorted.
When you can.
Nobody asked you, noseblow.
Idina slid the box toward her and peered over the top. Sure enough, there was the promised pool from their two-person bet, a new Xbox system, complete with a tangle of cords and two remote controllers with the batteries taken out. She pushed the box away again and popped the rest of the protein bar into her mouth.
Where are the games?
Nice try. That was never part of the package. Cake spun with a grimace and headed toward the open pantry to rummage through the food he hardly touched. Pretty shit deal if you don't include the games, she muttered, watching him from the corner of her eye. Or the batteries. Fuck you. Skim snorted and immediately wiped the smirk off his face when Cake gave him a warning glare. The rest of the unit watched Cake and Idina in silence.
Okay, shouldn't be too hard to get under his skin. Just act like him and turn my nose up at all the things he cares about, starting with his warped sense of integrity around paying up on his lost bets.
When Idina had her regularly scheduled Monday evening therapy appointment the following week, Dr. Sullivan was equal parts amused by and skeptical about Idina's new tactics.
I'm guessing it's fairly useless to ask if you can't simply bring up the topic of his interests and hobbies.
Ha! Huh. Idina slumped back on the hard yellow couch and slung her arm over the armrest. Totally useless. I'm pretty sure he hates me.
Why is that?
Because he's the only corporal in Triple S. He didn't do anything with our unit, and here comes Private First Class Moorfield to change things up and make him feel like a lazy slob.
Hmm.
Sullivan leaned forward on her bright green rubber exercise ball that served as her office chair. It squeaked in protest under her shifting weight. Did he directly express this to you?
No.
Idina fixed her therapist with an amused frown. He doesn't directly express anything to anyone, unless he's telling you to go fuck yourself.
That's not exactly rare among Army personnel.
I know that. I'm not doing this for fun or to get back at him for anything. She picked at the two small threads of the armrest's upholstery, starting to fray. This is for Major Hines.
You're still giving him reports daily, then?
Yeah. At the end of the day, every day.
Once you've found this so-called key to unlocking Cake's strengths and skills, then what?
Mission complete. Idina slowly dropped her gaze to a rucksack resting on the floor in front of the couch. Major Hines gets his information about every soldier in Triple S, for whatever reason he needs it, and I get answers.
Sullivan followed her gaze.
About the journal?
Yeah. Are you trying out some different copycat method of therapy or something? Because I've already told you all this, and you don't forget the details.
Well, look at you.
The woman sat back on her bouncy chair and slapped her thighs.
Private Moorfield shrinks the shrink. Go on, tell me more about myself.
I'm just saying. After a few seconds, Sullivan huffed out a laugh, and Idina joined her.
I'm helping you through the process one more time, Idina. It's important not to lose sight of our ultimate goals, especially when the available means to get there can be a little hairy.
I don't think any of the guys in my unit can grow facial hair, and they're all in their 20s. Sullivan snorted.
You're deflecting.
You didn't define hairy.
Hmm.
Folding her hands on her lap, Sullivan gazed around her cramped, eclectically colorful office and inhaled deeply.
You said you are trying to play Cake's game.
I'm not trying. That's what I'm doing.
Fair enough. You think he hates you? Maybe he is as big of an asshole as he sounds. Who knows? Fighting fire with fire doesn't make us immune to getting burned, though.
Idina chuckled and rolled her eyes.
You think pretending to be an asshole to figure him out is gonna end up turning me into an asshole?
I think it's easy for you to get caught up in the how, which eventually ends up obscuring the why.
What?
Sullivan gave her a tight smile, her eyelashes fluttering.
Yes, Idina, I think your plan to spy on the asshole might turn you into an asshole.
I'm not gonna hurt him or anything.
Maybe not physically.
Listen, in my extensive career as a psychotherapist, working with mostly military personnel, I've learned a thing or two.
Included somewhere in the jumble of crap my brain has filed away over the years is an understanding that the only difference between adults with authority problems and children with authority problems is puberty. That's quite literally between them.
Idina laughed and folded her arms.
Very funny, doctor. I'm flattered.
And serious. Sullivan reached toward her desk behind her, and whisked a single sheet of paper off a stack in the corner. Then she faced forward again and handed the sheet to Idina. You might want to consider alternative methods. After scanning the page for 5 seconds, Idina wrinkled her nose. Children and adolescents given catch-all diagnoses of oppositional defiant disorder, or conduct disorder, most often suffer from additional underlying trauma and PTSD. They feel they have no safe place to express their fears, worries, and insecurities, so instead they act out by breaking rules, throwing tantrums, and even resorting to violence. Really? I'd probably refrain from hugging him. Unless, of course, that becomes a mutual agreement between you two. Oh, come on. Idina tossed the sheet of paper onto the couch beside her. In case you haven't noticed, he's also a grown-ass man. Sullivan lifted both hands in concession and shrugged. I'm just saying, compassionate listening is an option. Maybe the reason Corporal Buntcake has a harder time opening up than the rest of your unit is that nobody's stopped to recognize the good he has to offer. So he's playing into the only role he knows others will accept of him. Wait, hold on. Idina pointed at her. Is this my therapy session or his? Or you could ignore everything I've said today, play the game his way, and most likely win. I've come to understand that's what generally happens when you set your mind to things. Then you can deal with the potential guilt and shame of having manipulated a member of your new unit into revealing some of his deepest, darkest secrets. Or at the very least, his valuable skill sets. All so you can complete this mission for your boss that, as far as I can tell, has absolutely nothing to do with anything. After a few seconds of blankly staring at the woman, Idina blinked and cleared her throat. Except for the fact that he promised me answers. Are you sure Major Hines even knows anything about anything? Well, I won't find out until I finish these reports for him on my unit and get the information he promised me. They stared at each other for a moment. Then Sullivan harshly laughed and waved their entire conversation away. You're right, Idina. I don't know what I was thinking. Why speculate when you have a mission and a goal right in front of you, huh? You know what? You got yourself into this position with Major Hines. I do mean the actual position. Who am I to tell you how to handle your missions? I'm certainly not on active duty. I'm not even in the army. I'm only here to shrink all your heads and sign off on the paperwork. Idina pursed her lips and slowly turned her head to eye the woman sideways. I feel like you're still mocking me. I am still mocking you. And myself, probably. Sullivan nodded at the handout of how to interact with behaviorally troubled children lying on the couch. Think about it. Either way, a mission is a mission, no matter how many people have no idea it exists. You always have such sage advice. Idina folded up the handout and shoved it into her side pocket. That's what you pay me for. Or why somebody pays me. It's probably not you. Or it's automatically coming out of my paychecks, and I had no idea I got a raise as Hines' driver. The thought made Idina choke back a laugh. With that? Sullivan clapped once. You're dismissed, Private. That doesn't mean the same thing when you say it. Oh, I know. It's still fun. The woman winked at her, stood, and headed toward her office door to hold it open for Idina's exit. On Thursday, I fully expect to hear all about how you tortured or nurtured Corporal Bunt this week. Have fun. Yeah. Puffing out a sigh, Idina shouldered her pack and flashed the woman a tight smile. See you Thursday. As she walked through the halls of the Behavioral Health Building, she couldn't help mulling over the nuggets of wisdom her therapist had managed to plant beneath all the sarcasm. Every soldier of the supply support section had landed in the brand new unit after being judged and labeled for their shortcomings in one way or another. Problems with authority? Maybe. Lack of impulse control? That fit with everyone. That was the whole point of the covert mission Major Hines had given her, wasn't it? He didn't want her to find and exploit her unit members' weaknesses. Those were pretty obvious by watching the soldiers exist from day to day. No, Hines wanted her to dig even deeper until she unearthed the things that proved none of them belonged in a section like Triple S in the first place. If I'm in there by mistake,
they probably are too. Not that anyone else in my unit has glowing green lights and sometimes freaks out a little too hardcore with them, but I can't recite an entire instruction manual. Cake's gotta have something. Nobody's completely useless.
Idina didn't think the way to Corporal Bunt's talents was through playing nice and catering to his abandonment issues. Either way, she was about to find out how far she could push Triple S's ranking soldier before he finally opened up. Or punched her in the face.
Chapter 3. With their go-kart complete, courtesy of Stop's Wonder Brain, Idina returned to sneaking into Captain Iron's office first thing, because dropping Major Hines off at work in the same building every morning gave her an hour's head start on the rest of her unit. She wasn't surprised to find a single new work order resting on her OIC's desk, and no one in her unit questioned how she knew what they needed to do day to day. Captain Iron still hadn't made an appearance at the supply room, either to check in on the fledgling unit he was responsible for, or to ask how the hell they'd completed these remedial tasks without him having ever passed along the message. Idina had a hunch Major Hines had told the captain to stay out of his office, do whatever he wanted with whatever other units were under his command, and not ask questions about the misfits in Triple S, or the successfully and efficiently completed jobs around the HHC building and the surrounding few blocks that no one else wanted to take on. Either way, it made Idina's job easier. The unit kept busy, she didn't have to work all that hard to find them something to do during the day, and it opened up a lot more time to focus on exactly how to crack Cake open like an egg so she could finally get some answers of her own. She took every opportunity to butt into whatever Cake happened to be doing at the time, reading inventory catalogs, munching on slightly stale crackers from the open pantry, swiping through his phone. Then she'd make some kind of comment that felt particularly Cake-like. What the hell made you think that was a good idea? Dude, leave some for the rest of us. Wow, must be a fun time at the Bunt House during Christmas, huh? At first, the rest of her unit looked at her like she was insane. At one point, after she'd commented on the way Cake had slicked his hair back that morning, he replied that she should go lay down at the motor pool, and maybe someone would finally run her over, all while mussing up his hair and storming out of the supply room. Trunk drew her aside and tried to be the mediator between them.
Why you gotta ride his ass like that, huh?
Idina stared up at the enormous, nearly 7-foot specialist, who wasn't in the field because it gave him seizures, and tried to keep a straight face as she shrugged. I'm tired of his shit.
Yeah, you're not the only one.
Nobody else is gonna say anything to him, except for me. He's gonna explode in your face, Badge added as she peeled an orange at the table. Good, maybe he needs to explode. Nothing like a good icebreaker, right?
Idina's attempts to seem nonchalant about the whole thing were convincing, because her unit backed off after that. For the rest of the week, the 5 other soldiers busied themselves doing something else whenever Idina and Cake volleyed insults and verbal threats. The pair let fly across the supply room, the parking lot behind HHC, other supply closets around the building, or wherever they happened to be on any given day of janitorial work no one had officially signed to them. Sometimes, the other soldiers snickered or muttered comments around how intense things were. Most of the time, they kept their mouths shut and focused on the work Idina had brought them, without anyone suspecting that was what she'd done. At least, she didn't think they suspected it. Her Thursday appointment with Dr. Sullivan didn't bring up anything new on the topic. Sullivan seemed a lot more interested in hearing about what Idina had discovered on her own, about the 300-year-old green leather journal that had once belonged to Lady Gavina Mearden of Scotland. Idina didn't want to share her progress on that one yet, so she kept changing the subject.
I sense a little resistance to opening up to me today.
Sullivan folded her arms and cocked her head. Care to tell me what that's about? Not really. So for the last 20 minutes of her hour-long session, she mimicked her therapist's posture and entered a silent staring contest with the woman. Afterward, though, she wondered if what Dr. Sullivan had warned her about on Monday was true.
I'm not being an asshole. Not really. I'm trying to get the job done. Once Major Hines hands over the serious carrot on a stick with whatever he knows about the journal, I can quit pretending to be something I'm not.
In addition to keeping her thoughts to herself during Thursday's therapy session, Idina didn't feel like sharing with Major Hines the details of her efforts with Cake, either. On their drive from HHC to his home, in one of the modest residential neighborhoods on Post, he surprised her by bringing it up himself.
Any luck with Bunt?
She wanted to slam on the brakes, but settled for looking up at him through the rearview mirror instead. I'm working on it, sir.
Sure. Any little nuggets you'd like to share?
Not yet. Idina focused on the road again, although she didn't have to at this point. She'd been driving the same route twice a day for the last 2.5 months, which made it second nature. When I figure it out, you'll be the first to know. Hines snorted and flipped through the pages of a GQ magazine he must have purchased off Post in the recent past.
Hopefully, I'll be the only one to know.
That's what I meant.
Uh-huh.
As she slowed the SUV to a gentle stop at the next red light, Hines dropped the magazine into his lap and stared at the rearview mirror.
Feel free to share your strategy, Moorfield. I might be able to offer a few tips.
I've got it covered, sir, but thanks.
You know, a little collaborative brainstorming never hurt anyone.
Idina drummed her fingers silently on the steering wheel. Fortunately, the light turned green, which meant she had an excuse to keep staring straight ahead instead of looking up to meet his gaze in the mirror. I agree with you, but I think if you wanted to be part of the process with Triple S, sir, you'd be in there with us to study them for yourself. Somehow, she felt the major's gaze on her for the next 5 seconds, even though it was through a mirror and not head on. Then Hines snorted, shook his head, and returned to his magazine.
Suit yourself.
Honestly, that was how Idina preferred to do almost everything, on her own. Unless it was a mission for the whole unit or a training exercise, she was better at putting the pieces together by herself, without interference from anyone else. Until Major Hines ordered her to tell him exactly what she was doing to find the strengths and skills of the last soldier in her unit, she planned to finish the rest of this little side mission without giving anyone a look behind the curtain.
Cake's not an idiot either. If he suspects that I'm trying to play him on purpose, he'll quit the game altogether. Then I'm screwed.
So the next day, Idina decided to turn up the heat. Of course, she was impatient to get the corporal to open up to her, because it meant receiving information from her company commander that she hadn't gotten from anyone else in her life. She tried not to think about how strange it was that HHC's company commander had insight into an antique journal with the same weird magic as Idina's, or that she'd started to occasionally think of it as magic and not a glitch in her frontal lobe. A bigger motivator than her impatience was that her week of running Cake through the psychological gauntlet was ending. When the day was over, they'd be off duty for the weekend. That meant 2 days for Cake to cool down and come back to work in the supply room a lot more refreshed and probably more hardened to her snide comments and Cake-like attitude than he'd been when she started. Plus, she had a feeling he was onto her. Or maybe he'd turned up the heat himself. There was only one way to find out. Triple S was in the communal bathrooms beside what served as the bays in the HHC building. They couldn't be called bays compared to those in reception or at the other company barracks for the 307th, mostly because they only had enough room for half a dozen beds. The bathrooms were relatively the same size. Pill and Badge argued for 20 minutes over whether or not it was appropriate for the entire unit of 5 men and 2 women to all be in the same bathroom together on cleaning duty. Badge eventually won, meaning they'd all clean each bathroom together. After that ended, Idina decided to close in on Cake and squeeze him as hard as she could. The corporal stood at the long row of steel sinks, staring at the bottle of bleach Badge had slammed onto the counter. He hadn't touched the rag next to it, and it didn't look like he was about to dive into the group project anytime soon. Idina folded her arms and headed toward him. You know, if you're worried about ruining your nails or something, we have a box of gloves. Cake leaned toward the mirror above the sinks and bared his teeth so he could pick leftover breakfast from between them.
Then go get gloves. I'm not cleaning shit.
Idina could feel the rest of her unit's gazes on them, but she wasn't trying to impress anybody. Quite the opposite. What's wrong? You can't pick up a rag and do one useful thing like the rest of us?
Whatever you're trying to do, newbie, I'm telling you to shut that shit down right now.
Or what? You'll sit back and waste space even harder. We're all busting our asses over here to— He slammed a fist down on the metal rim between sinks and spun toward her.
What the fuck is your problem?
You. She shot him a deadpan stare and leaned back against the closest sink. I thought that was pretty obvious. Scoffing, Cake flipped her the bird.
You're a fucking joke.
Says the guy who keeps following us around like a lost little puppy but doesn't have the balls to do anything else. The bathroom had fallen completely silent, and the only reason Idina noticed it was because of Stop's boots squeaking on the linoleum floor as he shuffled nervously from foot to foot.
Listen, Cake muttered. I don't know what crawled up your ass this week, but I'm this close to losing it on you, so back the fuck off.
Ignoring the blank stares from the rest of her unit, and Badge shoving Skim back when he tried to step forward in a short-lived attempt to break up the tension, Idina did exactly what Cake would have done if they'd switched places. She did the opposite of what he wanted, pushing away from the sink and stepping toward him with a sneer. Sounds like somebody needs a good cry and an early bedtime. He hissed out a sigh and shook his head, flipping her off again as he turned back toward the mirror.
Nope. Can't let him turn away like that.
She took another step closer.
Hey,
or maybe what you need is for someone to kick your ass into gear.
For fuck's sake, back off.
It's been a while since anyone cared enough to smoke you in the first place, right? Come on, admit it. You kind of miss it.
I said back the fuck off, Moorfield.
He lunged toward her and shoved her viciously away with both hands. Idina honestly didn't think he'd lose his shit that quickly or have an outburst like that. But all the jerk energy she'd been channeling, and the fact that he'd caught her off guard, made her instincts kick into gear the second she stumbled back against the last sink in the row again.
Hey! Dude, just... You don't get to do that.
She stormed toward him with no idea what else she would have said or done. Cake was ready for a fight. He probably even wanted it. When he raised his fists toward his face, and her green lights flashed all over the tense muscles of his right shoulder and upper arm, Idina had pretty much stopped thinking and went right into sparring mode. Cake swung at her with a right hook that probably would have made Trunks stumble and see stars if he'd been sitting. She ducked, avoiding the blow completely, and lunged forward to ram her shoulder into his gut.
Whoa, whoa, whoa.
Trunk marched toward them.
Y'all are insane.
Cake doubled over and immediately grabbed Idina's wrist, grappling with her either to push her off or to get in another good swing. They struggled for another second before Idina wrested her wrist from his grip and turned to sock it up into his gut. She only meant it as a blow to get him off her, but now she was as riled up as he was. So was her magic. The second her fist connected with his stomach, a dazzling green light burst from her hand. Cake flew backward across the bathroom, passing the entire row of sinks before he landed heavily on his back and kept sliding with a squeak of his boots across the floor. The crackling green energy of her punch rippled away from his stomach to his waist and up to his shoulders. By the time it fizzled out of existence, he'd stopped moving. Completely. Then everything was quiet again, and nobody moved. Including Cake.
Chapter 4. In the deafening silence of the men's bathroom, Idina drew in a quick, shuddering breath.
What the actual fuck? Badge shouted. Grimacing, Idina shook out her fist.
Shit. That ain't the kind of answer we're looking for, newbie.
Trunk stood motionless 6 feet away, staring at her with wide eyes like everyone else.
Better hope you didn't fucking kill him.
She hurried toward the corporal she'd launched across the bathroom because her plan to piss him off had backfired. She'd been so focused on trying to push his buttons that she hadn't paid attention to hers.
Cake.
Dropping to her knees beside him, Idina scanned the guy's body for any sign of severe injury. Of course, she had no idea if that was even possible with her violent magic, because this was the first time she'd hit someone head-on like this.
Hey, Corey, are you—
Don't ever call me that.
He picked his head up off the floor to glare at her, then dropped it again with a grunt.
How many times does a guy have to say, back off, before you'll fucking listen?
With a sharp laugh of surprise, Idina slid back a little on her knees to give him some space.
Hey, I'm sorry.
All good.
Grunting again, he turned over onto his side, pushed himself up off the floor, and stood like he'd been sitting there having a picnic.
I'm fine.
Bullshit!
Badge pointed at where they'd had their standoff in front of the sinks, then at Cake dusting off his hands.
She fucking launched you across the room. That had to feel like a damned train.
Nope.
He brushed down the front of his OCP shirt and sniffed.
I maybe felt a little tickle. Bro.
Trunk looked him up and down.
Nobody doesn't feel a punch like that. Even me. I'm not you, am I?
So drop it.
Idina swallowed as she studied Cake's seriously weird reaction. He didn't grimace or limp as he headed back toward the mirror above the sinks to stare at his reflection and slick his hair back again with both hands. If they hadn't seen what she'd done to him with their own eyes, if Idina hadn't punched him herself with an added boost from her magic, none of them would have believed she'd hit him.
You didn't feel a thing?
She was hesitant to approach him now because none of this made sense. Cake snorted.
I felt it, newbie. Just didn't hurt. Nice try, though.
Man, there's no way.
Yeah, there is.
After turning his face this way and that in the mirror and stroking his hairless chin, Cake spun, leaned against the sinks, and shrugged.
Look, I'm not fucking with you guys. I just don't feel shit that hurts.
The hell does that even mean?
Exactly what I said.
Wait, hold on.
Idina pointed at him, narrowing her eyes. You don't feel pain? Cake shrugged again and tried to play the whole thing off like it was no big deal.
Dude.
Skim grinned at the guy.
That's friggin' awesome. Not really. I mean, if I got my foot sawed off, I wouldn't know until I tried to walk or bled out. Kinda sucks dick.
Badge pulled her utility knife from where she kept it strapped to her uniform, flicked it open, and charged toward the guy.
Well, it's to test this shit out.
Uh-uh.
Trunk grabbed her by the shoulder and hauled her back. A slow shake of his head was enough to get the message across, and she scoffed before putting her blade away where it belonged. Idina was still too focused on the discovery to care about how anyone else did or didn't try to prove what she already completely believed. How does something like that happen?
Fuck if I know.
Cake looked all around the bathroom, but suddenly couldn't seem to meet her gaze. She didn't blame him. Then he turned his attention to Pill and tossed a hand at their hypochondriac soldier.
Ask the walking textbook.
Everyone looked at Pill, waiting for an answer. He seemed incapable of anything but staring at Cake, his mouth open in disbelief.
Maybe you should tell us instead,
Skim offered.
Nah, there's nothing to tell.
That's bullshit too.
Cake rolled his eyes and didn't look particularly interested in anything at the moment. Still, he was talking about himself.
It's called congenital pain insensitivity. I've had it forever.
So you have no idea what pain feels like? Idina asked.
I said it in fucking English, didn't I?
Yeah, but it's not something you hear every... Something small and coppery shot through the air and smacked Cake square in the forehead. He hardly reacted as the penny clinked onto the floor, bounced a few times, then rolled in a tight circle before finally wobbling over and lying still. He looked up across the bathroom at Stomp and blinked slowly.
Seriously?
Congenital insensitivity to pain is a medical condition in which the ability to...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.